Tonight, as I've already indicated, we will be hearing from Professor Chisholm. And education is one of those aspects in our society which we have not gotten right. If there is something that we have failed post 1994, it is in the field of education. When we get first year students, we still see gaps that should not be there. And the reason for that is because perhaps we don't have all the knowledge that we require to put our education system on the right path. Some people even claim that it might be because of the resources that we have deployed in our schooling systems. Some people even think that it is because of the unionization nature of our education system. But all that actually indicates that much more work needs to be done in terms of research to understand the sources of our problems, and not just for the sake of understanding them, but to correct them so that in 20 years' time, we are not talking about the same issue of underpreparedness of students. We are not talking about the issue of low graduation rates that we are witnessing in our educational system. We are not talking about whether our graduates and our high school students, everybody who is coming out of our educational system, are competitive enough to put our economy on the right path. I hear a great deal of our political leaders talking about a developmental state and South Africa aspiring to be a developmental state in order to mobilize enough capital to be able to deal with the problems of unemployment, the problems of poverty, the problems of inequality. But if there is one thing that if we can be able to sort out, it will give us a better opportunity to tackle all those problems, is actually education. And I know a great deal of us, especially when we listen to people speaking, we talk about education. What we are not doing is actually to do. And Professor Chisholm has done quite impressive work that we all are going to listen to. And I am looking forward to listening to her. And I'm also looking forward to the respondent, Professor Noor Niftagodian. I hope I have pronounced it correctly. I know, welcome to the University of Johannesburg. We're also looking forward to hearing from you. With those few words, I would like to introduce our esteemed Executive Dean, Professor Salki Gravett, to come and introduce our inaugurant.
Thank you, Professor Marwala. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, colleagues. It is indeed my privilege to introduce to you Professor Linda Chisholm. Professor Chisholm is a professor in the Center for Education, Rights and Transformation at the University of Johannesburg. She's a former special advisor to the Minister of Basic Education in South Africa, director of the Education and Skills Development Research Unit at the Human Sciences Research Council, professor and chair of education at the University of Natal, now KwaZulu-Natal, and director of the Education Policy Unit at the University of the Witwatersrand, Johannesburg. Before this, she was a senior lecturer in the education faculty at Wits. A history honors graduate of UCT in 1976, she went on to obtain a postgraduate certificate in education from the Institute of Education at the University of London in 1978, her master's degree at the School of Oriental and African Studies of the University of London in 1980, and a PhD also in history at the University of the Witwatersrand, Johannesburg, in 1989. She is on the International Advisory Board of the Journal of Curriculum Studies, an associate editor on the International Journal of Educational Development, and past editor of the Southern African Review of Education and Perspectives in Education. Professor Chisholm has published widely on the historical, contemporary, and comparative aspects of education policy and curriculum in South Africa and the region. Amongst her publications are 15 books and monographs, 22 book chapters, 44 articles in refereed journals, 32 research reports, numerous book reviews, several articles in popular journals, and a fair number of newspaper articles. Professor Chisholm, we look forward to hearing you tonight. And on a personal level, I share today with our Deputy Vice Chancellor, Professor Parekh, that I'm particularly delighted that you are bringing back to the faculty a comparative education focus, which we haven't had for many, many years. Professor Chisholm.
Okay, the focus tonight is going to be historical, not comparative. Let me begin by saying that student and worker struggles on university campuses have in recent weeks been as all-consuming as the now almost forgotten textbooks struggle was in Limpopo a bare 4 years ago. We hardly remember that now. But then as now, references to the past were as strong and as strong undercurrents in all the debates that were occurring as they are today. Debates about the reasons and the origins of the failure of the state to deliver adequately have always a subtext of the historical. Okay, at the time of this Limpopo textbook crisis, I was intrigued by a kind of nostalgia that was doing the rounds, very different from today's calls of decolonization. A kind of nostalgia that leading public intellectuals were expressing for the excellence of mission education on the one hand and the order and discipline of Bantu education on the other. I was interested as a result in finding out what the situation had actually been as far as textbooks were concerned, but the problem was finding textbooks from the 1950s and the 1960s, textbooks that had actually been in use in schools. Somebody suggested that I go and start with mission archives, and when I found myself unemployed in Germany in late 2014, I started to visit the Hermannsburg archives to see what I could find, if I could find references to the kinds of textbooks that were being used so that I could try and track them down and find out what the situation had actually been as far as this was concerned. Well, I found a treasure trove that took me way beyond textbooks. I came across a wealth of correspondence between missionaries, inspectors, principals, and teachers, and numerous others that spanned the crucial years of the introduction of Bantu education in 1953. I found lists of books that were ordered from the schools both before and after 1953, and I also found painful correspondence about the transfer from mission to Bantu education and how the mission had negotiated and dealt with this. So I began to think about the transition from mission to Bantu education, and that a perspective that brought to bear what we now know about the transition from apartheid to post-apartheid education on this early period might yield interesting insights. So what this lecture will do is reflect on a fragment of what I found in those archives. Because we know quite a lot about curriculum and teachers, and a lot more about Bantu education, about its other aspects, I'm going to focus in this lecture on mission control and influence and textbooks and medium of instruction. Okay, now one of the main and common contributions of theoretical approaches developed under the broad rubric of transnationalism, transition, and post-colonial theory has been to break down the distinctions between either the past or the present, the national and the international, or the colonial and post-colonial. Transition studies, for example, have taught us a great deal about the complexity of transitions. Think about outcomes-based education, for example. In our own case, the elite pacting that accompanied the transition, the language of crisis in which the earlier system of education was cast to legitimate change, the grand visions, the policy compromises, restructuring and reorganization, the distance of policy talk from local school realities, the failure of many policies to take root, and their often painful and unintended consequences. Much of the writing on transition in education from the apartheid to post-apartheid period has focused on these issues. Transnational studies similarly try to break down the dividing lines between national units. They emphasize networks spanning national boundaries, the centrality of linkages, and the transoceanic flows of people, goods, and ideas. South Africa's educational history, we all know, coming from education, has also been deeply informed by such networks of people and ideas crossing national boundaries. From our recent educational history, we know that the idea of OBE, for example, traveled across state boundaries, and that reshaping the new, ideas, different kinds of ideas were borrowed, but that they were also transformed in the process of adoption by local actors in different social realities and different contexts. Now, similar to transition and transnational studies, most of you will probably be more familiar with post-colonial approaches, which also recognize that the distinction between the colonial and the post-colonial is a pretty fluid one. They're not neatly separated, but interpenetrated, in the sense that the past is very much part of the present, much as the present constructs the past, and as much as the present today prefigures and will be part of the future. Post-colonialism has also crucially involved a move away from binary oppositions of colonizer, colonized, first world, third world, and black and white, through recognizing the unstable, fractured, and hybrid nature of social realities and identities. It seemed to me, with this play of different theoretical approaches, that this would be a productive way of trying to understand the transition from mission to Bantu education as a transition that may have been unstable and fractured, resulting in hybrid forms. Now, there is a huge and substantial literature on both mission and Bantu education, as well as on the continuities and the discontinuities between them. I need to say something very briefly about this. What we know from the literature is that when the Bantu Education Act of 1953 finally did make provision for the transfer of control of mission schools, there was nothing new about the idea. It had been much discussed and debated locally and internationally in colonial conferences and journals throughout the 1930s and the 1940s, when the Iceland Commission was in process and after it reported in 1951. Some of the key authors on this topic are in this audience tonight. Iceland, according to one of them, simply expressed the dominant wisdoms of his time. So although there was opposition to Bantu education as segregationist, there was also much agreement that things had to change, that the state had to take over control of education, that it couldn't remain under mission control. The crisis in mission schools that Hyslop, for example, had written about had been manifesting itself in food and discipline riots in the immediate post-World War II years, and this simply underlined the fact for many that things had to change. More recently, Peter Calloway has argued that the Lutherans were responsible for Bantu education on account of their support for and the centrality of mother tongue to Bantu education. And I'm going to be looking at this in a bit more detail, but I think he generalizes from Iceland and the experience of the Berlin Missionary Society to all other Lutherans, who included Norwegians, Swedish, Americans, and so on. In addition, the Lutherans were not the only mission proponents of mother tongue education, as I will show, but that's just a kind of sub-issue in the whole thing. But there is then a literature about the transition from mission to Bantu education, but it focuses mainly on the ideas from the 1930s and 1940s to Iceland. But this agreement on the fact that things needed to change explains in part why, according to Richard Elphick in his monumental book, The Equality of Believers, why he argues that leading missionary schools capitulated when they were confronted with the option of either retaining control of their schools at reduced subsidy or relinquishing them to the state. In the closing pages of his book, Elphick shows how one by one the great mission schools decided to close their doors without much protest. They included Lovedale in the Eastern Cape, St. Peter's in Johannesburg, Grace Dieu in Petersburg, and Adams College near Durban. There was no opposition from the German. Thank you. Hi. You've got more important things to think about, but thanks for coming. There was no opposition from the German Berlin Missionary Society branch of the Lutherans. The only opposition from amongst the missions themselves came from the Roman Catholic Church, which chose to go private. The Hermannsburgers, as I will show, complied and attempted to leverage retention of influence through negotiation. They were partially, but not completely, unsuccessful. So, within this grand narrative of the history of Bantu education, its implementation went relatively smoothly, despite a schools boycott that was organized by the ANC in 1955. Now, with some exceptions, the cumulative effect of this literature has been to see an obliteration of the mission past rather than its continuity into the Bantu education present. And this may be because, with very few exceptions, the majority of studies, probably because they're English, have focused on the fate of the well-known elite oppositional English-speaking mission schools that produced the leaders of the African nationalist movement. And the dominant understanding here is of a major break with little continuity from the past. Not enough, in fact, virtually no attention has been paid to the less visible, poorer, much more ordinary mission schools that were part of mission societies that had a much lower public profile than the richer, bigger, more vocal and visible ones. And this is where I now turn to the Hermannsburg Missionary Society. Who were they? Okay, they were one of the smaller Lutheran German societies founded in a dorp in the middle of nowhere in Germany that is well known for being picturesque and somewhere between Bremen and Hanover and Wolfsburg, which is now better known for the Volkswagen crisis. But it's in the middle of nowhere. The society was founded by Louis Harms, who sent a bunch of missionaries to Ethiopia. They landed in South Africa by accident. They arrived in British colonial Natal in 1854. And although they shared a highly gendered patriarchal social organization with the Berlin missions, for example, they differed in their social origins and theology. Most of them were either craftsmen or farmers, and they were not from wealthy, urban, or highly educated backgrounds. Unlike the Prussians from the Berlin Mission Society, whose Lutheranism was an amalgam with Calvinism, the Hermannsburgers chose a more original form of Lutheranism. I don't know much about Lutheranism, so I'm not going to say much about it. But once ordained and sent out to South Africa, what they typically did, and these, what you can see here are just names of the mission stations and the schools in Natal, and then from 1857, when they founded them in the Transvaal, they settled in the Transvaal and in Natal. But what they would typically do was get engaged to a young German woman in Germany, be sent to a mission station to learn the local language, either Zulu or Tswana, for a year, and then thereafter they would be given their own mission posting. One must say that their wives were a constant part of where they went and what they did, but they played a secondary and a supportive role to the missionaries whose working lives and networks were almost exclusively male. Okay, they've been described as a farmer's mission, a mission of plattelanders, and they, as I said, they established this network of stations with satellite outstations in the Western Transvaal and Zululand on land granted either by chiefs or by the Natal colonial government or by Paul Kruger of the Zuid-Afrikaanse Republiek. They quickly integrated. Now, well, what happened to them once they arrived in South Africa? They made these trips. They came with a particular set of ideas. They quickly integrated into rural white and particularly Afrikaner society, with whom there was a natural sympathy given their anti-imperialist and anti-British stance during the South African and First World Wars. This also meant integration into the racially defined social structures, although they played an intermediary role between local ruling white and African societies. And some of you may have heard or know about the story of Penshorn and the Buffer King. As Africans were not allowed to buy land during Kruger's Republic, the mission bought land throughout the period, throughout the early 20th century, during the time of the Land Acts, bought land on behalf of the Buffer King. And there are writers who've written subsequently about what happened, but that had significant consequences. So although they weren't part of the colonial power in Natal, Britain, they nonetheless played a colonial role in attempting to colonize consciousness through converting people to Christianity. Apart from the German boarding schools for their own children, segregated, they established the segregated network of smaller schools in both provinces wherever they built churches for Africans. They were opposed to the use of English in their schools, but by the 1920s, most missionaries were unable to fund schooling on their own, so they received grants in aid, and in exchange for provincial grants, they taught, or the medium of instruction was English. So the medium of instruction was English, but they also had a firm belief in the mother tongue. And so they taught Swana, the mother tongue, alongside English in their schools in the Western Transvaal and in Natal. At first, they used London Missionary Society readers for their Tswana schools, but later they developed their own. But the education provided, as we all know, was extremely rudimentary. In 1924, for example, the Bethel Institute, which was set up to train evangelists, start a secondary school, and also to train teachers, it didn't go beyond Standard 6. And this remained the case for several decades. Okay, the end of World War II brought the National Party to power in 1948, which of course immediately established a commission of inquiry into education under the chairmanship of the son of a Berlin missionary, Vannevar Bely Max Iselin. He had been a chief inspector in the Transvaal, chief inspector of native education in the Transvaal. It was a very powerful group of chief inspectors in each province throughout the 1930s who played a key role. They mainly came from mission backgrounds, but they played a key role in intermediating between the schools and obviously the departments. But his position had brought him into contact with them over matters of schooling, and so his ideas were not foreign to them. But although they agreed, and this is of course just a little bit of detail on where I differ with Calloway, although they agreed on some aspects of the policy that was to become Bantu education, there were also some key differences. Okay, now let's get to the stuff of what I'm supposed to be talking about. Starting with the different theoretical approaches which emphasize that there isn't a neat break between past and present, national and local, international, national and local, and so on. I think that when you look at the transfer of mission schools to Bantu education, and particularly at this particular mission, you do see fractured, continued mission influence. So in the first instance, you see, when we're looking at control over schools, the Bantu Education Act gave missions a choice between going private or handing over their schools if they were in reserve areas to African communities whose state-appointed Bantu school boards would run the schools, or to farmers, white farmers, if they were in white farming areas. It threw the Helmansburg mission into disarray, because although they recognized the need for state control, given their own extremely limited financial resources, they weren't able to continue supporting the schools, they still wanted to retain control over the schools and some kind of influence, moral or Christianizing. They wanted to retain some kind of influence over the schools nonetheless. In addition, the reality that confronted them was 100 times more complicated than the law envisaged, as there were a variety of different schools in different kinds of situations that did not fit neatly into the kind of racial map that was being articulated for different schools. How were they all to be fitted into this map? They didn't understand how they were going to do it because the schools were all in such different places, had such different modalities of control and so on. So these were matters of great concern to them. There was also the question of the ownership of buildings. If they had built the buildings together with local communities and they were now to hand them over to white farmers or to school boards, what happened to the fact that they had some kind of controlling stake in it? And so what happened was that the process was in many cases very protracted as they tried to negotiate these issues. The initial strategy was to delay the decision by pressing for clarity and expressing a need to manage the extreme confusion and insecurity that had broken out in their ranks given the complexity of the situations. So they engaged and interacted with departmental officials by letter and in person. In this process, they arrived at compromises which they fixed in law by contract. And just very briefly, as far as farm schools were concerned, there was a whole series of complicated legislative impositions with which they had to comply, which made life extremely difficult for them. For example, leasing land on which their schools were to farmers for £1 a year, in exchange for which they could then become the managers of the school. Nonetheless, they still needed the permission of all those farmers whose workers' children were being educated in these schools. Many farmers, as they said repeatedly to government, simply weren't interested in the school, so they didn't know why there was this this attempt to enforce the control by farmers over schools. The department harassed them throughout the 1950s to comply with the law, and schools were simply closed if they didn't comply. In 1958, there were also further regulations to allow farmers to use children for farm labor during those periods in the curriculum that provided for gardening and handwork. When I did a study on child labour in that very same area in the 1980s, the practice of child labour was well entrenched. Now, just bringing it up to 1990, the Lutherans gradually lost control of these schools. They were the managers, but actually they weren't in control. The schools became subordinated to the interests of farmers who weren't interested in the schools. But the Lutherans still, in some instances, owned a lot of land, and they formed a property management company, which in 1990 commissioned a study of what had happened to all these schools. It was written by people, as you all know, John Aitchison and Wendy Lieb, but this report makes for really bitter reading. It describes the system as feudal, where farmers had, in effect, become not only the owners but also the managers of the schools. In most cases they were opposed to the schools. In many cases they managed the teachers as if they were their farm labor. And the schools themselves by law did not go beyond standard five. Absenteeism of teachers, malnutrition and various parasitic infections were suffered by most children. And most children left school before standard two. Whatever they learnt was in any case, very little could have been absorbed. Facilities and educational aids were virtually non-existent. Teachers were lonely, isolated, and felt unsafe if they were female. Mostly they were dispirited. The reports of their classroom teaching was that they were dispirited and their teaching methods were uninspired. Children in sub A were taught English by rote, and Afrikaans was introduced in standard one. There's no report on the mother tongue being taught. But the report reported that after 6 years, the children could speak neither language, neither English nor Afrikaans, and were simply confused. And I'm going to say something about textbooks later that will reflect back on this. Agriculture, a compulsory subject, was, according to the authors of this report, taught in a totally arid way and is an ironic waste of time for children whose entire environment is agriculture. The Lutheran property management company had no budget for schools, and what spending there had been to improve infrastructure was at that stage drawn from donor aid. So this is like a terrible story. You all know these farm schools. In fact, they all, many of them are still with us. And also the children. If you remember, Njabulo Ndebele said in his introduction to the speech by Piketty, he wondered what had happened to all the people who were resettled during the 1960s and 1970s. These children who were leaving school before Standard 2 by 1990 and the early 1990s are still part of our system. Okay, so that's farm schools. In Bantustans, schools on land in areas designated in Bantustans, the situation was slightly different. Here, the missions retained partial influence for a short period, but not for long, mostly because the local communities weren't interested in having them, because they were simply not interested in the religious instruction which the mission was interested in pursuing. But at first, what they did was they negotiated contracts first with the state. So the state would lease the buildings from them on behalf of the school board. And in exchange, they got a right to be represented on the school committee. And they had the right to teach religious instruction. But this didn't last for long. By the end of the 1950s, the state reneged on the agreement to pay the rents and required local communities to pay on the spurious grounds of the need for them to be self-reliant. This was a big basis of Bantu education. And so the situation became much more difficult as most were simply unable to pay. So missionaries lost control for a variety of reasons there. The situation was different, or they were in a better position with schools on land that they owned themselves. And this was the case with the Bethel Institute, a teacher training college and school situated near Lichtenburg in the Western Transvaal, whereby, students burnt the school down in 1953. In fact, that could have been the alternative lecture that I wanted to give, but I didn't give, as to what happened. They burnt the school down, it was rebuilt, the new principal that was appointed came from the Hermansburg stable. He wasn't a missionary, but he was a son of a missionary. He had educational qualifications. And the person who was put in charge of the hostels was also a Hermansburg mission person, and this lasted right up until the 1980s. So the school remained, in essence, a Hermansburg mission school or teacher training institute until the 1980s, when the mission was forced to sell the property to the state. So, and these are just pictures taken by the principal of the hostel in the 1970s, who wrote a book about it. It is now a girls' school. It has been completely rebuilt. These buildings are very typically kind of buildings of the era of 1960s and 70s. It's a completely different kind of school. But by 1969 then, although the mission had diminished influence over its school and its context, role, and position within them had changed dramatically, it still had some influence within schools on land that it owned itself. All I want to show with this little story is basically that what happened to mission schools was not as straightforward as it is often presented. It was, in fact, quite messy. The educational consequences were varied. In farm schools, at least, the educational legacy carried over into the post-apartheid period was pitiful. And by the 1970s, apartheid policies for the removal and resettlement of people were taking their toll on people and schools in mission areas. Missionaries were increasingly fighting a losing battle as they and the people living on their farms and attending the schools over which they still had some influence faced eviction and removal. As people were forced to move, either from the farms or small towns, they left with their children, and so the rationale for a school was lost. In the process, the mission itself became radicalized, and then from the 1970s, key figures emerged from within its ranks to fight apartheid alongside the other radical theologians that emerged during that time. So that was the first area of continued messy, difficult, conflictual, fractured, hybrid kind of continued identities from the mission period into the apartheid period. But I also want to just briefly look at continued mission influence in the development of textbooks in the form of readers that were developed in schools. How did Bantu education change what was taught in these mission schools? What was taught in the schools depended, of course, as we know, a great deal on the books and the teachers available. And the focus here isn't on teachers, but suffice to say that the vast majority of teachers who were trained in mission schools had no more than a lower primary certificate or 8 years of schooling. Mission schools used both teachers brought from abroad as well as locally trained teachers, but they were not well trained. The situation didn't improve during apartheid, qualifications fell. By 1968, almost half of the teachers still only had the lower primary certificate, and in short, greater access led to declining quality. But what kind of textbooks did the teachers have? Just briefly, in the 1930s and 40s, the records show that there were shortages of all books, and especially of books in the mother tongue in all schools during the 30s and 40s. This was still the case in the early 50s. Book grants in 1948 made the purchase of some books possible, but only readers and supplementary readers were made available and could be bought with a grant. But still, the grant wasn't adequate to cover the number of books required in all languages. Typically, the books that were ordered by the missionaries were readers in either Zulu or Tswana, depending on whether it was Natal or the Transvaal, and the two official languages in the 1930s and 40s already, as well as a map, a geography and history book. The numbers ordered were extremely small, limited by the grant, and intended to be shared. School expenditures for one set of schools in the Natal Zululand area showed that, as a rule, also more was spent on sewing materials and gardening tools than on books. So very few books in the schools. Did this change during the apartheid period, as some of those who think back nostalgically to that period would have wanted us to believe? So let me just have a look at some of the readers that were used. And I'm going to be looking at both the English and Afrikaans readers before and after the apartheid period, as well as Zulu and Tswana readers that was used. Now, one set of English readers that was definitely used in the Hermanusburg schools in the Transvaal before 1953 was the Sadie Melba series. Now, it was very typical for readers in English and Afrikaans to be authorized by inspectors. Normally, they had a preface in which the chief inspector of native education in the province authorized the book, or the author of the book would say that this was done with the approval with and the help of that particular inspector of education. Often, a co-author of these readers were these inspectors. But this Sadie Melba series is quite remarkable because it was one that was authorized by Iselin himself. And the images on the covers are similar to those inside. They are notable for placing African children in rural areas, in nature, among animals, or as servants in homes. Each story in the book is a simple moral tale. In most of the story, the character has bad habits, which include greed, laziness, dishonesty, thieving, dirtiness, and so on. And these bad habits are then corrected by learning a lesson via a mythical character or somebody else who enters into the story and teaches a lesson. In addition, virtually all black people are represented with indistinguishable, featureless faces. In short, the stories are quite offensive and racist. So, for example, here's a typical story of Lazy Jim, who his mother told him to wash the dishes. He always left them half dirty. If he had to sweep the floor, he left half the dust. If he had to clean the shoes, he only half cleaned them. an incident occurs, and by the end of it, the moral of the story is, from that day, I am pleased to say, Jim mended his ways. Now he does not leave parts of the garden without water. As for that tree, he never forgets to give it a good watering. Now, that was an English reader that was used, But the use of the home language or mother tongue in the early grades was also considered extremely important by all missionary societies before Bantu education was introduced. And I have Natasha Erlang to thank for referring me to the London-based International Missionary Council's Committee for Christian Literature for Africa, which together with the London Missionary Society, through the Lovedale Press and the Lovedale Principal Shepherd, played a particularly important role in stimulating discussion of how to develop literature in the vernacular. They called two major conferences in 1936 in Johannesburg, to which all the leading African writers were introduced, who also, it turned out, were writing books that were being used in schools in the 1930s and 40s. The Welsh Commission of 1936, for example, lists books available by African authors, including Glaumont and a whole series of others whose names would be familiar to many of you, for use in African schools. So there was an awareness, a consciousness, an attempt to promote and develop mother tongue. There was also some discomfort amongst many of the African authors themselves, expressed in the minutes, that they felt that this might be linking up with the segregationist legislation that was developing, and so there was some suspicious about development along their own lines and how that this played into that ideology. But the conference resolved to find possible ways of ensuring further development. So far from mission, from mother tongue education being the brainchild of Bantu education or of the Lutherans, it was the stepchild of a range of missions and mission educated elites across national, denominational and language divides. I haven't said anything here about the problematic nature of the way in which the languages had been developed, but I assume some of you know about that, and that's another story altogether. Now, so you've got these English readers, you've got an emphasis on the mother tongue, you've got some readers that were developed by the Lutherans, the Lovedale Mission Press, and so on, already being used, readers in the mother tongue being used in mission schools. So what happens after Bantu education is introduced? I came across a list, 1955, of prescribed books for all schools. There are two lists. Basically, as you all know, English, Afrikaans, and the mother tongue. Whereas before it had been English and the mother tongue, now it was to be English plus Afrikaans plus the mother tongue, and readers are provided for all of those. But the content was intended, you all know this, but I think it just needs to be said, it was intended to expunge the Eurocentrism that was supposed to be part of the content of the readers and the books and the histories and so on that were part of mission education literature and readers. And the new literature was supposed to be, the new content was to be localized, decolonized, de-Europeanized, linked to the local environment. So what this prescribed list does is prescribe vernacular readers produced, and this is the interesting point, what they prescribe are the readers that had been produced by the mission societies themselves. So on the prescribed list of the 1955 Bantu Education Act are the readers from the London Missionary Society, the Paris Mission Society, the Berlin Mission Society, the Helmsburg Mission Society, they're all there, plus a couple by new Afrikaans presses. Interestingly, only readers in the early grades were to be made available free of charge. All the other books, history, geography, and there were lengthy prescribed lists of books, none of those was to be free. They were all to be bought by the children themselves. Now, just a little bit about these readers. I'm going to start by saying something about the Afrikaans and English readers, because they're in the second and third language. Because, Peliwe, don't run away, because this is where it comes to you. Peliwe, when she was at Umalusi, the analyses that were always being made, okay, no, that's fine, but often the analysis is made in the Umalusi literature that part of the problem in languages and reading and so on in South Africa is that the mother tongue has not been developed as well as or in the same way as the second and third languages. And I think it's interesting then to compare and to look at the readers that were produced for Afrikaans and English and in the mother tongue in this early period, because I think you see a similar thing. You see quite remarkable and interesting differences. In the Afrikaans and English booklets or readers that were produced, each one was mostly they were all written by a combination of an author plus an inspector. Sometimes there were African authors involved. But they always spoke about using a scientific method, the direct method, which meant that you had no mixing of languages in class. If you were going to teach English, you were going to teach English. If you were going to teach Afrikaans, you were going to teach Afrikaans. It was also a phonics-based approach. In the English readers, for example, and there's very little I can show you, but there's a great emphasis on vocabulary acquisition, word frequency, and comprehension. So English readers for South Africa by A.S.V. Barnes, edited by Franz, Chief Inspector of Native Education in the Transvaal after Iselin, and J.H. Dugard, another inspector from Natal, who incidentally was the father of our own John Dugard. Anyway, here's a typical kind of page from an English reader. There's a vocabulary at the top, stories, and I'm not going to say anything about the representations because there's not much time, but you can notice it yourselves. And similarly here again, new words and the story. And then there are grammar exercises that normally follow at the end. So in each of these booklets, there are the stories, there's vocabulary acquisition, there's grammar. There's quite a lot of grammar. There's filling in the blanks, there's all that sort of thing. The Afrikaans readers are similar. Phonics-based, varied representations. And incidentally, I must say that when I found these books, the librarian who gave them to me said to me, and I was taking them all out, and Sandile Zwani was photographing them for me and so on. He said, "What do you want all these things for? These were the books we had." And he must have been in school in the 1960s, 70s. So these books were still being used at that stage. But there's a typical pattern to them. Now, regardless of what was in them, remember what Lieben Aitchison said about the farm schools for which these books were ordered. Even after 6 years, children could speak neither English nor Afrikaans and were simply confused. I'm not saying that there was a problem with the method. The conditions of use, the nature of use, the teachers, all of those must also have been decisive. But what's interesting is to compare them with the mother tongue readers, which, as I said, were taken over from the mission presses. Mostly, the content emphasized the local and the ethnic, I'll show you. Mostly, they were fairy tales, folk tales, myths, and religious stories, and there was much less grammar. Phonics in the first year, and then much less grammar, vocabulary, or any kind of exercise than you would find in the second and third language readers. Whether more was being learnt is not unclear. But for example, this Tswana reader, which was produced by the Hermansburg Mission Society, that's a very typical sort of lesson. And here I just wanted to show you the localization of content that was happening already in the 1940s and the 1950s, history of South Africa, but history of the Tswana. We know about that. And similarly with the Zulu readers, racialized representations of white leaders and tribalized Africans, and then a history of the Zulu. Here, just the cover showing the authority relations of the desired authority relations between teacher and taught, and representations of the work the people were expected to do. Here, I just want to show you, just here's the end and the start of a chapter. There's not much in the way of, for example, if you compare it with the English and the Afrikaans readers, there's not much by way of vocabulary, new vocabulary being introduced, or any grammar or anything like that. So let me just end with what the relevance is for us today. I have not gone into a great deal of detail, there is much more to say about it, but I think suffice to say that I think that looking at these early readers, even without taking into account the teachers and how they were taught, I think there are implications for learning. What we learn about is how people learned to read historically, perhaps, what the textbooks looked like, and this has implications for us today. Do these patterns that were established here, are more recent patterns building on those, or have teaching practices and pedagogies been entirely changed? What are the implications for those early periods for today in the teaching of reading? I also think, I mean, I haven't gone into great detail, but there's a difference of coloriality, using Walter Mignolo's phrase in a slightly different way from the way in which he intended it, from the differences between the mission, the colonialism of the mission period, the colonialism of the apartheid period, and the colonialism of the post-apartheid periods. There's a long history, for example, of localization of content. So as far as decolonization is concerned, this is not a new thing, so it has to consider new issues of power relations and values and so on. So as I said in the abstract, when we're looking at decolonizing the curriculum, we need to be cognizant of the past in order not to lock ourselves into new ways that seem to be new but are simply repeating the past. Another point I think that emerges from this is that the mission school model just isn't a model. The private school model on its own just isn't a model. It's been mixed throughout South Africa's history. There hasn't been a time when South African schools have not been inspected by the state. There hasn't been a time when mission schools weren't being funded in some form or another by the state. It's a non-starter to think that it's possible to start private schools from scratch without any interconnection with the state. So it's a kind of myth. So I'm sorry to be a party pooper on this, but when we on this question of nostalgia for the past and that we can revive the mission schools, which was an issue that maybe came up in the context of the textbook debate and perhaps isn't so relevant now, but it was quite important for me when I started doing this, it's just a non-starter. So anyway, I think that the relevance for us today is just that this tells us a little bit about the importance of looking at history to understand that there are no clear breaks between past and present, and that even in a decolonized future, there are going to be aspects of the present that come from the past continuing into the future. Yes.
Great, thank you very much. That was really wonderful. I have a very clear mandate, and that is to speak for exactly 4 minutes and 59 seconds. So I'm going to start slowly, and if I pick up speed midway, you're just going to have to follow me and not fall asleep before then. So as you were talking, I just want to digress for a second and add to my 4 minutes and 59 seconds. I was in fact struck by some work I did in Alex Township a number of years ago and interviewed a number of really old people. And the first thing that occurred to me is that they refused to be interviewed in one of the vernacular languages. And the reason they insisted on being interviewed in English is because they said that they were from the mission schools, right? And they refused to be taught in or to speak in the vernacular language and insisted on speaking what they regarded as impeccable English. So I think these kinds of ideas about and the complications about mission schools, what they represented, and a kind of political reaction to Bantu education is quite complicated. And I think that the kind of ideas that you've raised in relation to that I think are pertinent. So let me start. First of all, I think I want to thank the University of Johannesburg for the invitation, and as I said at the beginning, to make a few very brief comments at Linda's professorial inauguration. And I think, in fact, not only to speak to the paper and its broader consequences, but I think to celebrate excellent scholarship over a long period, because we often forget that when we do these inaugural lectures, we focus on what is being presented and sometimes don't have a sense that there's this broader celebration. And I know from my own engagement with critical scholarship on education, Linda has undoubtedly been one of the key influences. But as Linda said at the beginning of her talk, I cannot think of a more appropriate moment to talk about education. It's a wonderful time to engage critically on education. And of course, it's wonderful to do it at the University of Johannesburg, that has over the past few days been the epicenter of debates and struggles about precisely these issues. In fact, I was going to entitle my talk something like hashtag Professor Linda Chisholm Rocks, right? so that we could combine it with the very famous hashtag of the Brixton 141. My next point really is that when Linda called me to ask me to say a few things, as I reminded her earlier, I agreed almost immediately. I can't remember whether I agreed before you finished. I just said, yes, I'll do it, right? And I'll tell you why. Because I was, for me, this was an act from your side of profound collegiality. Between scholars from University of Johannesburg and Wits University, which I think is important. And in the last week, in fact, it has been epitomized by the solidarity in the struggle against fees and against outsourcing by scholars, by students, and by workers. And I think that your invitation I see as a spirit, in that spirit of collegiality and solidarity, which I think importantly transcends the very narrow and meaningless competition over ranking that preoccupies the managers of our universities. So, I think I was asked to do this because I'm an historian, not because I know anything about education. So let me make a few points very briefly, and I can only do this in an abbreviated form. As I read through the paper, it struck me that the research and arguments that are articulated in the paper exemplify Linda's scholarship as an historian and education expert. Her work has at times focused on local histories, going back to the 1970s, but throughout, in fact, for example, on the Limpopo province, but has consistently also been transnational, focusing on other parts of Southern Africa. While in the post-1994 period, as most of you know, Linda has brought her expertise to bear on critical debates in the education policy arena. In the time given to me, I'd like just to make a few brief comments on some of these specific and some of the salient arguments in the paper, and then raise a couple of issues which I think speak to some of the broader implications that flow from these salient points. It's of course impossible, as you will have noticed over the past 40 minutes or so, to do justice to the excellent paper, and I'm not sure how many people have read it, but I've read it a few times, which provides, I think, important insights into mission and grant education, and again, far more detail in your presentation on the complexities and deep problems related to textbooks, language policy, and the like. I should just say that, and this I speak as an historian, obviously, what is very important about this, and I, as an historian, I check footnotes, right? And as you mentioned in your introduction, this paper draws heavily on archives. And I think it's sometimes a skill that people either forget or dismiss. And I think that what you've done here is to bring your expertise as an historian, the archival research, plus, I think, very insightful theoretical frameworks. The paper, while acknowledging the existing scholarship on the transition from mission to bunt education, in fact provides, I think, an important critique of that of the extant literature in a number of ways, but I think especially by, in the case of the paper, by emphasizing critiquing the emphasis in the existing literature on English missions to the marginalization and perhaps even exclusion of other mission histories. And I was struck, by the way, and I didn't know this from the paper, by the one map that you showed about the extent of this mission. I mean, the footprint was kind of all over, you know, the old Transvaal and parts of Natal, and the and therefore their exclusion from the existing literature, I think, is of course a serious problem. And I think your correction here is extremely valuable. The paper challenges the dominant perceptions about the transition from mission education to Bantu education by demonstrating the multiple points of interpenetration between the two that very importantly persisted in various forms for a considerable period after the formal introduction of the latter and apparent demise of the former. Drawing on transition and post-colonial theories, the paper eschews any idea of a neat dichotomy between mission and Bantu education. This, in my view, is one of the key contributions of the paper, which is important not only in relation to the historical research and speaks very powerfully to a debate that has preoccupied historians for a long time. And that is the debate about the continuities or discontinuities between segregation and apartheid. And in a certain sense, that debate has faded over the last 10 years or so. And what this paper does, in my view, is offer new insight and provides new layers of analysis to this very important debate. Now, I'm going to come back to this question of transition because I think it is important not only for the period that you're talking about, but also for the contemporary. The paper also shows how ideas circulate across space and time. And in this instance, from, as you say, a very small, nondescript German village to the rural heartland of South Africa in the late 19th century and into the 20th century, shaping the ideologies and practices at the key moment of the origins of apartheid. And again, you will be familiar with some of the contours of this debate that has suggested in one section of the argument that apartheid was simply a product of the conservatism of Afrikaners. And I think what this, again, enters into an old debate, but I think provides important new insights. Central to the circulation of ideas, as Linda indicated in her introduction, was the circulation of racist and, very importantly, patriarchal notions that influenced the pedagogies both of mission and Bantu education. Eurocentrism was hegemonic in both periods. Of course, it's an irony of Eurocentrism because the emphasis given on localism, in fact, was an entrenchment of Eurocentric ideas, right? And therefore, that process of decolonization was a process shaped by profoundly Eurocentric ideas. Perhaps the most trenchant section of the paper, which is done in a very abbreviated form, comes at the end of the paper with a critique precisely of the localization of content, which Linda insists is not sufficient to ensure decolonization. What I want to do in the minute or so that I have left is just reflect on what I think are some of the broader implications of the paper, which, let me emphasize, is an important analysis of a critical moment in our history. What Linda's done, I think, so I only want to raise two or three points. So the paper effectively dismisses the nostalgia of conservatives who hanker for an imagined past to critique the present. Of course, we need to critique the present, but this kind of nostalgia of this ordered past is something that we need to confront head on as if what existed prior to where we are now, and particularly this kind of this nostalgia for order is something which I think we need to confront head on, and I think Linda, I think, does this excellently. So the selective and problematic invocation of the past in fact undermines any serious project of substantive transformation. A salutary lesson from the paper relates to its critical analysis, in my view, of transition. It is especially apposite in thinking about, in my view, the transition from Bantu education to the democratic dispensation. Because we often think that 1994 marks as clear a break as we had between mission education and Bantu education. In the research that Linda herself has done and others following or inspired by her research, what has been uncovered, for example, I can only here refer to one example, is the extent to which Bantu education continues to seep into the present. Let me put it this way, rephrase that. Bantustan education, right, continues to seep into the present, both in the form of the people who teach, the policy makers, and the officials in the form of Bantustans. So that the idea of a clean break is something that needs to be problematized, especially in our conversations about what decolonization should mean and what we still have to deal with in terms of legacies of the past. So what does this mean for the project, the contemporary project of decolonization? I think we can conclude from what from Linda's paper that the process of decolonization cannot be left to those who are in power. Because invariably those who are in power, whatever the ideologies are, reproduce relations of power. They may implement what are apparently far-reaching changes, but power relations remain largely intact. And the various kind of practices, the systems, and if we can take our universities as an example, we apparently have had a process of decolonization, but in fact at all our universities, we basically have feudal structures still in place, of councils, of senates, etc. So that the discussion around transformation, around decolonization, is both about the content of curriculum, but also power relations, not simply outside the universities, but inside universities. So that the content and practices of decolonization need to be authored and driven from below. So, in conclusion, I think that Professor Chisholm, as we all know, is a leading proponent, and I'm claiming you, right? a leading proponent of social history of education. A rich corpus of research is reflected in this paper, and as you will have heard from her introduction, which is informed by post-colonial and transnational theories. She has once again cast a critical scholarly eye on the past and, in my view, on the present, and has produced the kind of scholarship that should be animating our discussions on a decolonized curriculum and university. Thank you.
The University of Johannesburg. Rethink, reinvent.